All right. And so I want to do something a little different today. Oh, sorry, I'm trying to be fancy and what have I done? Let me just get that off altogether. I thought I could get my cursor. That's better. Okay, now I've got it there. So I see that I've got a pointer. I hope you're seeing that. I can point at what I'm going to do today. And I'm going to talk today about the fact that we are celebrating Martin Luther King Jr.'s holiday on Monday, and thinking about the lens that Dr. King's activism, philosophy, legacy gives us for looking at American politics in 2022. And so I'm not going to completely depart from what we've been doing together, but I do want to really use that lens to maybe focus on some issues that we wouldn't otherwise focus on. And so in doing this, I'm then going to start with recent developments in politics this last week. It's been, I think, in certain respects, a watershed week. And I'm going to focus on a couple of issues here. One of them is the fact that, as we know from just a day ago, the Supreme Court put a stay on the enforcement of the, and I've written mask, I'm sorry, it should be vaccine mandate, that President Biden's Occupational Health and Safety Administration was attempting to impose on all large employers with 100 or more employees. And the Supreme Court, in a complicated 6-3 decision, said that that was not constitutional, was not an authorized exercise of executive power. And on the other hand, they allowed the mandate on healthcare workers to proceed. And in weeks past, I've suggested to you that we're gonna have a very difficult time getting above 70-75% rates of vaccination in our society, unless in addition to trying to persuade people, we also incentivize them to do it. And that one of the most important incentives is mandates that basically say you cannot do the things that you want or need to do unless you are vaccinated. That includes going to work, going out to dinner, going to the movies, etc. And this is being done, as you are well aware, in many states and municipalities. Joe Biden was trying to do it nationally. His administration was trying to do it nationally for large employers, and the Supreme Court struck it down. And want to suggest this is going to be a major impediment. It's going to be a major impediment to getting up to the level of vaccination or immunity required in order to make the coronavirus endemic instead of pandemic, in order to make it something that is not spreading rampantly, going up and down and up and down, surge and trough for a year or two longer, which, you know, I think there is a scenario in which the virus of its own accord mutates in a way that pushes it in the direction of being endemic. But it sure would be good to not have to rely on being lucky in that regard. And the Supreme Court has prevented the administration from doing this. And I just want to note very briefly that Justice Kavanaugh, in his concurrent opinion, which is not the opinion of the majority, and so it does not become law or dictum, but instead is just his opinion on this case, attacked the delegation of legislative authority by Congress to the executive in setting up the Occupational Health and Safety Administration. This is sometimes called the de-delegation or anti-delegation stance of a strain of libertarian and conservative jurists who believe essentially the growth of the administrative state over the 20th and now 21st centuries is a violation of the principle of the separation of powers. And there are a lot of tangled questions around this, including how you interpret the Constitution. If you are an originalist, which I happen to think is an incoherent judicial philosophy, but if you are an originalist, that understanding that, that Congress can't delegate its powers to the executive might make sense. But if you're an advocate of any kind of position that views the Constitution as a living document that evolves as the understanding, the philosophy, the needs, the social circumstances of our society evolve, this really doesn't make sense. This principle that Congress can't delegate to the administrative state. And I just think it's worthwhile noting for a moment how radical this form of judicial conservatism is, that it would essentially undo almost all the major developments of the regulatory regime of the federal government going back to the beginning of the 20th century. It would certainly undo the New Deal, undo Great Society, but it would also undo drug and medicine and medical equipment regulation. It would undo a fair bit of food regulation, a lot of the stuff that we rely on to keep ourselves safe. Consumer product regulation is in jeopardy if enough members of the Supreme Court come around to this position on the delegation of congressional authority to the executive. And having said that, then I want to again bring in Dr. King's perspective on this and to note that we're in a peculiar position, right? Where the majority of justices on the Supreme Court have been appointed by Republican presidents and approved by Republican members of the Senate, despite the fact that those presidents and that constituency within the Senate have not been supported by a majority of Americans. And so that we are in a position where the Supreme Court potentially undermines Biden and his administration's ability to regulate in a way that brings the pandemic under control. As a result, the pandemic may go on. As a result, Biden's popularity and support may be undermined. As a result, we could see Biden being a one-term president, or to put it differently, Republicans regaining the White House in 2024, and then being able to further appoint more radical members of the judiciary who are going to be hostile not only to the entire expansion of the federal government, but also to a variety of civil and voting rights legislation. And I just want to be as clear as possible, right? That the civil rights revolution of the middle of the 20th century relied on using the federal courts and the federal governments to bring to heel the Jim Crow states of the South, but also to render unconstitutional practices in places like California and Illinois that were segregating and discriminating as well. And so I do think that this decision, right, has multiple implications, not only for public health and constitutional law, but also American politics. And then, of course, American politics remakes the Supreme Court, which remakes constitutional law. And so we could be witnessing the beginning of the, or maybe it's the middle of the unwinding of the civil rights gains of the 1960s in what's happening today in constitutional law and American politics. The second big development, and here I'll start by noting that Joe Biden gave another speech this week, a few days ago in Atlanta, that represented again his pivot from a more conciliatory position to a more aggressively partisan position. And again, the similar to the January 6th address, the positions is that as long as one political party remains a threat to democracy in the United States, it's very hard for the other party to work with it. As a matter of fact, it's probably unjust and illegitimate to treat that party simply as another equal and equally legitimate political party. And whereas, right, there's the issue of trying to cover up or neglect or spread disinformation about an insurgency, an invasion of the Capitol, apparently in the service of a coup attempt, there is also the ongoing effort to tilt the playing field with regards to electoral politics. You probably saw that the Ohio Supreme Court overturned the Ohio legislature's districting plan and said that this was essentially like going to a casino where the dealer stacked the deck, that it just was on its face unfair, a clear violation of the minimum constraints, procedural constraints on fair elections. And so we might take some solace out of this, but Biden was pointing out this isn't just happening in Ohio. This is happening in every state in which Republicans are in a position to do this. And so he called forcefully for passing national voting rights legislation. And in order to do that, then for the suspension of the filibuster rule when it comes to voting rights legislation. And literally, not much more than 24 hours after he gave the speech, Senator Kyrsten Sinema took to the Senate floor to say that she would not support suspending the filibuster. And so it now appears that the effort on the part of the Democrats to shore up voting rights, and please note, again, the Supreme Court and the conservative leanings of the Supreme Court are at stake here. The Holder v. Shelby County decision of 2013, which invalidated some of the most important provisions of the 1965 Voting Rights Act, which had been reauthorized repeatedly by Congress, is part of what's making it necessary to pass new voting rights legislation in 2022, in addition to the fact that the Republican Party has increasingly decided that the best path for victory for it is to try to make it more difficult for its opponents to vote, to try to draw congressional districts in a way that skew the playing field, to try to, it appears now, intervene in the way in which votes are counted and transmitted, the whole process of registering votes. And so one of the questions here, now that Sinema has come out clearly against this, is what does this do to the Democrats? And to be as clear as possible, it changes the theater in which this contest occurs. If Congress could pass this legislation, it might be able to prevent the states from engaging in this mischief. But if Congress cannot pass this legislation, then Democrats are going to have to fight state by state, county by county, and this is going to be a difficult slog. It's improbable that the Democrats, I should say something stronger, it's nearly impossible that the Democrats will prevail in every state. And so there will be wins and losses, and where there are wins, maybe some of the mischief will be reversed via local or state action. But where there aren't wins, then the way in which the vote will be structured will be stacked against the Democrats, and it will be all the more difficult for them to win. They will have to engage in really quite remarkable efforts to get out the vote in order to overcome the impediments to electoral victory that are being put in their place by the other party. So the fight shifts from being about issues or candidates and into being about how to secure the right to vote. And again, from Dr. King's perspective, this has to feel like a return to the battles that were being fought throughout the long civil rights movement, especially in the 1950s and the first half of the 1960s in the 2020s. Now, I want to spend a minute analyzing why it is that the Democrats have failed to get both the voting rights legislation and the Build Back Better legislation passed, and whether or not there's any chance that they will succeed. Obviously, uniform Republican opposition is the baseline here. And unfortunately, unlike in the past, there is absolutely no cross-cutting ideology between the parties, no overlap or potential for working together in a bipartisan way on any of these issues. The Republican Party has become fairly adamantly opposed to anything that would be a success for Joe Biden. And that means that the Democrats have to go it alone. We add to that the rules of the Senate, right, which require for cloture in order to bring a measure to vote, that there be no filibuster, or alternatively, to shut down a filibuster, that you have 60 votes, right? That's where the cloture motion comes in. And that means essentially, unless the Democrats achieve a supermajority, then they can't get legislation passed, right? And please note that especially with Build Back Better, where so many of these measures are widely popular, the inability to put Republicans on their back heels and to basically say, okay, vote against universal pre-K, vote against child care provisions, vote against increased expansions for Obamacare or affordable housing, to force them in the way that would have been the case in the past, to vote serially on a series of measures, and instead to focus all the attention on a single piece of legislation, where, as opposed to most people pulling it apart, saying it contains this and this and this and this, we focus instead on the bottom line. How much does it cost? That has made things much more difficult for the Democrats. And this reflects the fact that in an era of partisan parity, which is the era that we're in, you know, there are going to be narrow majorities for either party in the Senate, the rules of the Senate make it very difficult or impossible to use our creaky constitutional machinery to get any legislation passed. And please note that the filibuster rule is not part of the Constitution, right? It's a Senate rule. It can be changed by a majority vote in the Senate if the Democrats could gain a majority. And please note also that in an era in which there are asymmetrical legislative ambitions, the Democrats have a much more ambitious legislative agenda than the Republicans, it's obviously to the advantage of the Republicans and to the disadvantage of the Democrats to maintain the filibuster rule, which I think is why you see a growing consensus on the part of Democrats. This used to be an out there left position. It appears right now that 48 Democratic senators would vote to at least suspend the filibuster rule on certain issues. And the final thing, again, I want to note, when we pull this back to civil rights and issues to do with protecting core political rights like the right to vote, one of the things we know from the history of the long civil rights movement is that federal courts and federal power had to be used to bring reluctant states to heel. And if the federal legislature is paralyzed. The action shifts to the states, and then it's much more likely that civil political rights are going to be rolled back. And this then, I think, brings us to a third factor. Why do the Democrats have to rely on Sinema and Manchin? And the simple answer is because they only have 50 votes, right? And so if the Democrats are really going to move forward in fixing the filibuster rule, in passing national voting rights legislation, in a more aggressive social provision legislative agenda, then they're going to have to get more than 50 votes. They're going to have to be in a position where they can essentially say, okay, Senator Manchin, okay, Senator Sinema, you vote against this. We've got the votes without you. Because it's become absolutely transparent that nobody within the Democratic Party, at least nobody to the left of Sinema and Manchin, has any effective leverage over Sinema and Manchin. And I want to talk a little bit about these two politicians for a moment and take you back to something we looked at together recently. And that is the perception on the part of large portion of the American population, right? 44% of all Americans believe the Democratic Party has been taken over by socialists. It's very high among Republicans. It's also quite high among independents, right? And please note, right, that especially with the case of Joe Manchin, he represents a state that Donald Trump carried by about 30 points. Yes, Biden won Arizona, but it's a very narrowly divided state. Manchin, especially Sinema as well, has to convince some of these people that think the Democratic Party has been taken over by socialists to vote for him anyway, right? And in order to do that, he has to be able to say, Joe Manchin has to be able to say, Kyrsten Sinema has to be able to say, look, there are a bunch of socialists. I'm the firewall. I'm keeping them from doing the crazy stuff that they would do otherwise. You have to reelect me in order to keep the socialists in the Democratic Party from running amok. And by the way, I think you're seeing, in a sense, a competition between Sinema and Manchin to be the water break, to be the vote that stops the Democrats from doing something that gives them more power or accomplishes their legislative agenda. So Manchin kills Build Back Better, Sinema kills the override of the filibuster for voting rights. Now, having said all of that, I want to be as clear as possible. It would be better if the Democratic Party had a larger majority and was not reliant on these two people who are in this position of probably being quite conservative, at least in the case of Joe Manchin, but also for structural electoral reasons, having to appear to their constituents to be quite conservative, that it would be much better for the Democrats not to have to rely on them. Having said all of that, I think you've got to also bear in mind that Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin are voting to appoint Democratic members to the judiciary. And I've been emphasizing the extreme importance of the federal judiciary here. Joe Biden has more appointees in his first year to the federal judiciary than any president, I believe, right? And you know, Manchin and Sinema, if I have it right, voted to impeach Donald Trump. Manchin is on record as saying he would vote to overturn Trump's 2017 tax reductions, right? And so just because they're not where we want them to be in terms of being with the vast majority of Democrats right now does not mean that they are dinos, Democrats in name only, or you know, Trojan horse Republicans. The majority should be bigger for, if the Democrats are going to get done what they want to get done. I've quoted to you Thomas Jefferson warning against building bold initiatives on the basis of slender minorities and tried to indicate, I'm sorry, slender majorities and trying to indicate to you why it is that Biden and the Democrats have felt compelled to do this despite the recognition of their slender majority. I don't think we can really blame them for having tried so hard to move along these two reluctant members to get their legislative agenda passed. It would do a lot, I believe, if they succeeded in changing the attitude of some Americans, the skepticism they have towards the federal government, towards the Democratic Party, and maybe start to open up new frontiers for federal political action in the United States. But it is clear at this point that they're not going to get Manchin or Sinema to go along. One reason, and I just want to emphasize this as a final reason, and this is another, I think, important asymmetry in American politics right now. And this is an asymmetry in news coverage. And this is something that the Washington Post prepared. I think it's quite fascinating. It's a diagram of the coverage of Donald Trump for an 11-month period from January to November of 2020. And please note that's the period in which his administration hemmed and hawed on the pandemic, downplayed it, and then the pandemic got much worse, circulated disinformation about how dangerous the coronavirus was, started to build up skepticism about the reliability of the American electoral machinery, and then ultimately turned against the outcome of an election he lost, right? So it's a period in which you can understand the media being quite critical of him, and the coverage of him was uniformly but moderately critical. Whereas Joe Biden takes office and has a fair bit of positive coverage. This coincides with his successful rollout of the vaccine, increased optimism about the idea that perhaps the pandemic would be brought under control. And then he plunges, and he plunges in July as the Delta variant makes it clear that the pandemic is not going away, and then stays quite low through the summer into the early fall as the disastrous troop withdrawal in Afghanistan occurs. And having said all of that, I just want to point out that basically on average, right, these two presidents come out with nearly identical coverage in the press, despite the fact, right, that Joe Biden is passing legislation that creates record job growth, record economic growth, brings unemployment down to nearly where it was in terms of pre-pandemic levels, successfully manages the rollout of the vaccine. Yes, there are some things that he did wrong and he deserved criticism for, but I think what this really reveals is the asymmetry in the press right now, which is you have one wing, one quadrant of the American media system, and it happens to be the most popular, the most widely watched stations, especially Fox News, that basically will not criticize Donald Trump or, for the most part, Republican politicians who fall in line with Trump, and will not praise Joe Biden or Democrats no matter what they do. Whereas the rest of the media ecosystem is much less directly partisan. They may have an ideological slant to their coverage, but they are going to criticize Biden when they think that he is mismanaging. And the result of all this is the credibility, as far as many voters are concerned, of the idea that the Democrats are socialists or that Biden is incompetent or worse, right? And so this is part of what makes Manchin and Sinema under pressure not to support Biden and the Democrats' agenda. Now, let me conclude very quickly by saying, I don't think, frankly, that the legislative agenda of the Democrats is completely dead. And as you may know, the United Mine Workers came out in support of Build Back Better and directly asked Manchin to support it, right? And it appears if Manchin supports it, probably Sinema will support it. And so the Democrats, I think, have to finally acknowledge where things stand, which is that basically, if you let Joe Manchin write Build Back Better, he will vote for it. So they're going to have to take what's sometimes called a skinny Build Back Better, a much pared down version of the legislation. And it's too bad that they can't get more if you believe, as I obviously do, that Build Back Better is designed to counteract 50 plus years of the erosion of the regulatory and social support capacities of the US federal government, and that it is long overdue, and that many Americans desperately need the support the federal government would give them if it was authorized to. But having said all of that, a little bit Build Back Better is better than no Build Back Better. And so hopefully the Democrats will come around to allowing Manchin and Sinema to say what they support and that they can support it. Similarly, although we're not going to get national voting rights legislation, we should, I hope, still be able to get a revision to the Electoral Count Act of 1887, which is the act that essentially opened the door, as we are now learning more and more clearly, to the hope that enough shenanigans, we now know, for instance, that Trump supporters submitted alternative slates of electors to the National Archives to try to put us in a situation where there were competing electors, some of them actually authorized by the election laws of the state, some of them just dreamt up by Trump supporters. Is somebody trying to ask a question? No, okay. Please, as always, feel free to come in. I can't see you when I'm in the slide mode. But all of that to say, more modest electoral reform law, more modest Build Back Better might still be passed. All right, so I now want to move out of the focus on last week's politics, but John has his hand up. Go ahead, John. You're muted.
Right, thank you. I'd like to go back a little bit to Biden's speech. Mm-hmm. In your comment on it, it sounded like you were kind of agreeing with his assessment of the situation. Peggy Noonan had an excellent column in the Wall Street Journal this morning. The title is Biden's Georgia Speech is a Breakpoint. She points to some of Biden's rhetoric, such as, quote, in our lives and the life of our nation, there are moments so stark they divide all that came before them from everything that followed. They stop time. And such characterizations of his opposition as, will you stand against election subversion, yes or no? Do you want to be on the side of Dr. King or George Wallace? Do you want to be on the side of John Lewis or Bull Connor? Do you want to be on the side of Abraham Lincoln or Jefferson Davis? And she cites, in contrast, McConnell's speech on the Senate, in the Senate the next day, which I saw a lot of. I didn't see Biden's speech. She thought McConnell's speech hit the nail right on the head in talking about how Biden started out as being the person who wanted to unify the country, and has now turned to a thing of totally demonizing all of his opposition as being racists and so forth. So her view is that he's now totally thrown away any opportunity of accomplishing anything whatsoever if he's gonna turn absolutely everybody against him. But the speech was just an utter disaster. I wonder what you think of that as strategy, not whether it was right or wrong, but as far as this, the strategy of delivering such a speech at such a time. People here in Piedmont Gardens seem to like it a lot, but
Yeah, so I'm I guess I would say I'm of two minds about this, but let me articulate both minds for a moment. On the one hand, for Biden to give that speech, and you know, without knowing where Sinema or Manchin stood, right? I think is characteristic of the whole first year of the Biden administration, which is the failure to recognize the basic math of the Senate, right? You can only do what your two most conservative senators will allow you to do. And so if you're gonna give that speech and you think that you've got some chance that you're gonna convince Sinema and Manchin to go along with you, then as a matter of political strategy, maybe it's the right speech to give. If you're gonna give that speech and you have no idea whether Sinema and Manchin will go along with you, and it turns out that, you know, within basically 24 hours, Sinema is gonna say, no, I'm not, then it's a strategic blunder to give that speech. So I guess I can go along with Peggy Noonan that far. But having said that, I think the other aspect of this is that Joe Biden came into his presidency seeking reconciliation, seeking normalcy, seeking the one way to put this is to turn the corner on Donald Trump, right? That the radicalization of the Republican Party was perhaps underway before Trump came along, but he accelerated it, exacerbated it, made it so nasty, so undemocratic, small d, so racist, that once he was off the scene, then maybe some of the people who Biden had worked with for years in Congress would come to their senses and be willing to work with him. They would recognize, as he put it in his inaugural address, that the nation was facing multiple crises simultaneously, and that the only way to address the crises and avoid the disaster that inaction represents is to work together. And so he started, and I think he tried for a year to work with the Republican Party. As I said last week, a year after January 6th, Donald Trump is stronger in the Republican Party today than he was, right, when he encouraged his supporters to invade Congress, right? Encouraged them to do things in service of a harebrained scheme to overturn the election, right? And so the idea that you could still work with the party that has maintained its fidelity to Trump, despite the fact that Trump lost the election, Trump is increasingly being exposed to someone who was plotting a coup, right? And at the same time that that party is working to subvert democracy, subvert the principle of one person, one vote, equal representation, at some point, maybe you have to say, here I stand, I can do no other. Or let me, as opposed to trying to work with them, point out to you who they are and what you would be voting for if you voted for them, right? And so that's why I'm of two minds. On the one hand, as strategy for getting anything done, it's probably bad politics. And on the other hand, frankly, the idea that Biden is going to get much done with this Republican Party is not very credible, right? So is Noonan saying McConnell was going to work with him until he gave that speech in Georgia? That doesn't seem borne out by the facts, right? And having said all of that, maybe Biden is hoping that giving speeches like this mobilizes Democrats to vote in 2022 in sufficient numbers that they possibly hold on to Congress. And that's the only hope the Democrats have of getting anything done in the remaining 3 years of his presidency. Thoughts about it, John, or anybody else?
No, that's good. Thank you.
Yeah, of course. All right, I'll pause for questions because I'm going to shift into something else. Let's go. I'm going right back where we left off, in particular to Robert Putnam. And I want to point out that, right, the assault on voting rights that is going on in the United States right now, and that, you know, Martin Luther King would be so aghast to see occurring in 2020's America, comes down to this idea of maintaining white majority power. I've tried to make that case to you. I've tried to make the case to you for many weeks now, drawing on Heather McGee and others, that this is a kind of self-destructive politics of status insecurity, but that it is very much alive. And the effort to try to take some of the vehemence out of this form of politics is very much behind the Democrats' desperation to pass Build Back Better. That this competes with a second model of politics, a model that says, look, we're becoming a majority-minority society. We have to figure out how to work together across race lines. And when we do, we actually can all be better off. This does mean surrendering any aspiration for racial status superiority and admitting equality. But if you do it, the benefits far outweigh the costs. Now, I've pointed out to you, right, that this plays out against a serious racial skewing of the partisan competition in the United States today, in which Republicans are a dominantly white party, the Democrats are a genuinely multiracial coalition, and this has primarily to do with the fact that white Americans without a college degree are strongly falling on the Republican side, that many of these people feel that they no longer belong in their country. There's a strong partisan skew to the idea that the changes in the ways of life in the United States mean that this is a worse country, that there is a strong element of ethnic or racial antagonism, right, in which people don't want people of non-Western European heritage to continue to grow as a proportion of the population, and that there's a strong correlation between those who score high on a scale of ethnic antagonism and those who don't trust elections and who believe we might have to use force, and that this is being widely perceived then as a partisan threat to American democracy. So where state governments are mostly controlled by Republicans, basically half the people are not very confident that the election will determine who gets elected, who gets to exercise power, right? And this then is also leading to bills across the United States to you let the legislature exercise election oversight, to let a partisan body count the votes, to meddle in the minutiae of the election, to impose criminal penalties for ordinary clerical errors, and obviously to gerrymander. All of that is to say to make the fight about the rules of the game as opposed to the policy agendas of the party. And this then takes me to Robert Putnam and Putnam's effort to get us to focus on economics, politics, society, and culture all at the same time, and to tell a history. And I know I'm moving fast. Stop me if you need me to, but I do want to get into Putnam's analysis of race because I think it's extremely important and illuminating and worth dissecting. So his claim is that in economics, politics, society, and culture, the big story of the long 20th century, the period from 1895 to 2015, is that we became more equal, we became more bipartisan and cooperative, we became more of a society of joiners and willing to work together, and we became more communal. through the first half of the 20th century, reaching a plateau in the middle of the 20th century, and then declining in the last third or four decades of the 20th century, to the point where we are now back more or less where we started. And for sake of simplicity, he calls this an I curve, meaning we were individualistic, possessive, competitive at the start and the ends of this process, but that in the middle, we were much more other-oriented, collaborative, cooperative. And he tells this story as one of a move from economic inequality to economic equality. I've reviewed that data with you. I won't review it again. Also as a move from political competition to cooperation back to competition. And so one way to look at this is inter-party feelings. Do you feel hostile to the other party, or do you actually have neutral feelings to the other party? And as you can see, from the 1970s to the recent era, the level of warmth to the other party has steadily declined. The sense of mutual suspicion and hostility has steadily grown. Similarly, political comedy, the willingness of the parties to work together, and this is kind of an aggregate that pulls together a bunch of different ideas, went up and went down. Right. And so that's the big story with regards to politics and what this does to our attitudes about government. Right. Declining trust in government from very high points in the 1950s and 1960s to abysmally low points in the decade that just closed. And political alienation. Do you believe the government works for everybody's benefit? That's gone way down. Or for the benefit of a few big interests has gone way up, right? And so again, if the federal government is going to be the instrument of preserving and promoting civil rights and racial equality in a multiracial America, we need to have basic trust in the federal government. We need to feel that it does our work for us, as opposed to merely working on behalf of a few big interests. So we've got some idea about what's been happening in economics and politics. There are two other metrics of comparison Putnam wants us to look at. One of them has to do with what he calls society. And by society, he means those organizations in civil society, outside of the government, outside of the economy, that bring us together in stable patterns of interaction in which we get to know each other, work with each other, trust each other, develop some sense of a capacity for collective action. And so he looks at the founding dates of major national membership organization and notes that this is a long graph. It goes from 1800 to 2000, that the second half of the 19th century is the period of joining and forming associations. And if we look at then who actually belongs, here's his upside down U curve again, right? Many people begin joining associations on his account with the move to urbanization. As people come to cities, they feel lonely, they feel isolated, they want to be brought together, they don't have the institutions that brought them together in the small towns or rural communities that they had lived in for generations. And so they found organizations to do that, and then they join and participate in those organizations, and that this goes up and up and up throughout the first half of the 20th century, and then beginning in 1960, it tails off and goes way down again. And this is true, right, for clubs, where the membership in clubs dwindles, people who go to them falls off from the 1960s to the present. It's also true for church attendance. And church here does not just mean a Christian institution. It means Jewish. It means any religious organization. And again, right, what's interesting is that the United States is perhaps less religious than we think it is in the late 19th, early 20th century. But then as the 20th century progresses, more and more people start joining and attending churches, and then it falls off again in the last third of the 20th century. Unions would be another example of this kind of institution. Here he's measuring the cultural salience of unions. How much are unions mentioned in the press, in books, in speeches, in movies? And as you can see, they go way up through the 1960s and way back down. And then marriages as well, as another integrating, stabilizing social institution. And it's interesting to notice that there were fewer adults getting married at the beginning of the 20th century than were getting married in the middle of the 20th century. And then of course it's gone way back down at the end of the 20th, the beginning of the 21st century. And so these trends affect culture, right? What's happening with social trust, right? The data doesn't go back as far as Putnam would like, but social trust starts out relatively high in the 40s, goes up higher into the 60s, and then goes down and down into the current period. What's happening with social solidarity, with the sense that I have things in common with and can work with other people in my society, goes up and up through the middle of the 20th century and then down and down. And this then measures generational differences in social trust. People born earlier have less social trust. People born in the middle of the 20th century have much more social trust. And then again, it falls off precipitously with the generation born in the 60s and the 70s. And then the final focus here has to do with the culture and ideas about belonging together, being part of a we, or alternatively, being an individual. And so one of the things he looks at is the way in which Christian theology treats, on the one hand, the survival of the fittest, and the way in which that declines and then starts to go back up, essentially a competitive view of society, as opposed to the social gospel, a more egalitarian understanding of Christ's teaching, and the way in which that goes up in the middle of the 20th century and goes back down overall within American Christianity in the last third of the 20th century. Similarly, terms like association, cooperation, socialism go up, 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 and down, down, down in that same basic inverted U curve pattern. So you're getting the idea here. And I do want to push on to note that one other thing that Putnam calls our attention to is the salience of identity. And it's worthwhile noting that this is a very interesting way of doing research. It's called an n-gram. It uses digitized data, in particular, the press, speeches, journalism, novels, and says, you know, how often was the term identity being used in the products of American culture from 1880 to 1940? Almost never. And then as you notice, it goes up and up and up. And Putnam thinks of identity as a marker of individualism. I'm concerned with my own identity, not with the common sense of belonging. And similarly, when it comes to responsibility, right, as opposed to rights, he notices that responsibility goes up, rights goes down in the middle of the 20th century, and then responsibility goes down and rights goes back up as we enter the final period of the 20th and the beginning of the 21st century. So all of this comes together in this I, we, I curve, culture and community versus individualism, integrating all the data. And now here's the big question. Who's the I and who's the we here? Is the we an inclusive, multiracial we in the middle of the 20th century in the United States? And I want to be as clear as possible. Putnam's initial answer to that is obviously no. But then he suggests we've got to look at the details. And very quickly, let me show you a little bit of what he has to say about race. And the basic argument, he says, if we think of our popular understanding of what happened with racial equality and justice in the 20th century, and we were to diagram it, it would look like a hockey stick, which is to say, the first 50 years of the 20th century would be a flat line in which there was a great deal of inequality, very little by way of progress and civil rights. And then beginning in the 1950s, things start to go up and they keep going up until the present. And he suggests that at least in certain regards, the data does not bear this out. And he's drawing on literature that refers to the long civil rights movement and suggests a revisionist narrative about civil rights and about the dimensions of social inequality with regards to race in America in the 20th century. And this literature suggests that actually progress in both civil rights and social equality was much more uniform throughout the 20th century, and much of it was in fact concentrated in the first 50 years of the 20th century. And so very quickly, if you look at the difference between life expectancy of Blacks and whites, right? We start out the 20th century with a very sharp discrepancy. But as the 20th century progresses, the difference between life expectancy, right? Blacks living 60%, two-thirds as long, 80%, almost 90% as long as whites. The Great Depression pulls it back down, but then it comes back up to the point where by the time you get to the 1940s, 1950s, Black life expectancy is up to 90% of white life expectancy. And then it plateaus, and then it goes up a little bit during the civil rights movement, then it actually goes back down. And please note, although it goes back up over the last 20 years, I suspect you may guess what's increasing the relationship, the Black life expectancy relative to white life expectancy, and that is that white people are living less long in the 21st century than they were living in the 20th century. The deaths of despair is bringing white mortality up, white life expectancy down. And so it's not affecting African Americans as much. And so the ratio starts to improve again. This is education in the South. Right? It's elementary, not high school education. And as you can see, these are white kids attending school ages 5 to 9 in 1900 and 1940. And one of the things Putnam notes in the book is that one of the big developments that drove economic equality in the United States for whites, but for the population as a whole in the 20th century, was the fact of universal free public education and its extension into high school. And what you can see is, right, that in the beginning of the 20th century, only about 40% of white children in the South were attending elementary school, ages 5 to 9. By the time you get to 1940, it's up to two-thirds. If you look at Black attendance, it's substantially lower, almost half the rate in 1900. But by the time you get to 1940, it appears there are actually more Black children, slightly more, attending school than there are white children in that age range. Now, those schools are segregated. Those schools are crowded and inferior in terms of the quality of instruction and textbooks and equipment. But kids are going to school at roughly equal rates. And you can see this for ages 10 to 14 as well, right? A gap in the beginning of the 20th century closed by the time you get to the middle of the 20th century. And then if we look at the country as a whole, at least the high school ratio closes, but again, it closes primarily due to change that occurs in the middle of the 20th century, at least a substantial portion of it before what we think of as the civil rights movement. And please note, here too, right, you get a plateau and even some declines in the late 20th, early 21st century. This is borne out even more clearly when we turn into things to do with income and wealth, right? And so with income, right, this is the black-white income ratio, right? And you can see we start out the 20th century with African Americans earning only about 40% of what whites earn. We get to the Great Depression. And then beginning in the 1940s with World War II, with industrialization, with the Great Migration, you have a dramatic closing of this gap where it goes from the low 40s up to the point where African Americans are earning in excess of 70% of what white Americans earn. Still a marked difference, but a substantial progress occurring in the middle of the 20th century, beginning again before the civil rights movement really gains the prominence, the visibility of the 50s and the 60s. And then note, right? Stagnation or even decline to the point where in 2010, African Americans are earning something similar to what they were earning in the 1970s. Black-white home ownership, similar trends. So to conclude, I just want to point out the factors that Putnam points us to in explaining why it is that in fact racial progress towards greater civil rights, greater equality occurred earlier than we think it occurred and didn't sustain itself into the last third of the 20th century, this revisionist account of the long civil rights movement. Part of this has to do with the Great Migration, right, which is extremely important. By the time we get to 1970, 7 million African Americans have left the South for the West, the Midwest, the Northeast. And in doing so, they've escaped Jim Crow, but they've also escaped a primarily rural economy, an economy without unions, and moved into areas where the right to attend school and the right to vote is clearly protected for them, right? And so part of this has to do with broader social patterns that do set the precondition for the civil rights movement, because as Blacks gain the right to vote in as they leave the South, the political parties have to become more responsive to them. And as they come out from under the daily terror, the constant threat of violence that the Jim Crow movement represents, they become better able to assert their rights. And this contributes directly to the long civil rights movement, to the idea that although the most visible protests and gains occur in the 50s and 60s, stuff is occurring already in the 20s when the NAACP is formed, when the initial lawsuits, the progenitors to the big victories of the 50s are actually implemented. The third factor that Putnam points to is that the American economy is becoming much more productive. Wages are increasing for all. And this does benefit African Americans, especially African Americans who escaped the South. By the way, part of his claim is that in reaction to the Great Migration, the South has to start treating Blacks better in order to keep African Americans from leaving. Fourth, and this I think is where things get really interesting in terms of thinking about the present. the internal logic of a self-reinforcing equalizing process. And let me go back just for a moment. I'm really trying to wrap things up with Putnam today. And so part of his claim is that these four dimensions of change coincide because they reinforce each other. As we become more equal economically, we demand greater political equality, and that leads our parties to cooperate with each other. We're more likely to associate with each other and to think of ourselves as all belonging together. And that in this respect, then, you can't say which of these developments is the causal driver, which one comes first and pushes all the others. He uses the metaphor of a flock of birds changing direction in the sky when they all seem to do it simultaneously, that perhaps is a better way to understand the movement to a more communal, more cooperative society in the middle of the 20th century. And just as all of this reinforces itself, each of these trends reinforces the other, once this is set loose, then it becomes more difficult to deny the implications of an egalitarian culture extend to African Americans. And so the claims of African Americans fall on more receptive ears when the United States has become more equal, more cooperative, more solidaristic in the middle of the 20th century. And that's another precondition for the success of the civil rights movement. The final thing I want to emphasize in terms of Putnam's account here is that when white Americans heard African Americans clamoring for equal treatment, for equal rights, for desegregation, for being treated as human beings and not as a member of a subjected, marginalized, abject class of despised persons, it was easier for them to hear those claims from a position of social and status security. The fact that their economic prospects had improved, that their social standing now seemed secure, made it less likely that they would want the prop of a despised group below them to hold up their own sense of self-worth, and so made it easier for white Americans to support Black Americans' claims for equality. As you can see, those increase substantially and consistently throughout the 20th century. And so to bring this all home, if we want to sustain and develop multiracial democracy in the United States, it may be that a solitary or exclusive focus on issues of racial justice and racial equality is not going to do the trick. That part of Putnam's story here is one in which the fact that the United States as a whole was becoming more cooperative, communal, solidaristic, and equal allowed for gains to start taking hold earlier than we appreciate and to be heard, acknowledged, and acted upon. Having said that, all of that, I've spoken with you a lot about racial inequality in the 21st century. There's a lot that Putnam's story leaves out. That will have to be, however, a story for another day. I've gone on and on. I wanted to finally get us through to the end of Putnam. Do you guys have questions, thoughts, things that you'd like to discuss as we approach Martin Luther King Day or in light of what we've been talking about? Go ahead, Marion. You're going to have to unmute yourself.
Yeah.
There you go.
Going back to Putnam's questions to people about the spirals that went up and went down again, it seems like he only questioned Republicans. He wasn't talking to Democrats, because if I compare the social and a cultural, you know, joining of groups and political awareness of my generation, which was high in the 60s and 70s. I don't think my generation, I mean, my children and my grandchildren have diminished in their social awareness and political participation at all. So it doesn't seem like our kind of folks were not in Putnam's questioned group.
Well, the other way to put this would be that maybe our kinds of groups are not fully representative of what's happening in the country, or alternatively, that what we see as engagement, commitment, is not quite what Putnam is asking after, right? And so to be clear, the vast majority of his research does not have any partisan dimension to it. And the parts that do have a partisan dimension are looking at partisan polarization on the part of both parties. And he does note that there's an asymmetry, that for instance, the negative partisan feelings are stronger on the part of Republicans looking down at or feeling threatened by Democrats than vice versa, although that might be starting to equalize or equilibrate at this point. But having said that, you know, so the issues that he might be interested in, you know, do your children belong to clubs and associations, or do they go to church or temple, or do they belong to unions? Did they marry at the same age that an earlier generation married at? And I don't want to personalize this, because Marion, you may have children that are totally exceptional. He's talking about broad social trends, but his reading of the broad social trends is that we have become less cooperative, less communal, less trusting, less joining, less equal, less willing to compromise in the last third of the 20th, the first couple decades of the 21st century than we were in the middle of the 20th.
I think that's more true of the Republicans than of the middle and upper class Democrats.
I take your point. I don't see that borne out in the data that Putnam is analyzing, but maybe that's a agenda for future research. Thank you, Marianne. Anybody else? Go ahead. Yeah, William.
Hi. In some ways, your talks give credence to the Republican view that tax cuts lift all boats.
Can you say a little bit more about that?
Well, each time Republicans cut taxes from the rich, they say, well, it's going to help the poor. The wealthy Republican business managers are going to give big raises to their employees and contribute more to society, which maybe some contributions come, but I don't think the pay raises come because the bosses are getting more money.
So I understand the view. I guess I'm trying to figure out how you think Putnam supports that view.
Well, the basic theory of, or it's a basic claim Republicans make when they push big tax cuts, is that everybody benefits from this.
Ah, okay. I see. So it's a claim that in a sense is a solidarity claim. I think Putnam's interested in that kind of rhetoric. You know, are you making your claim about it being good for everyone, or only making your claim about it being good for the members of your group? Is your orientation to politics more cooperative or more competitive? But then he also wants to measure that against actual data about social equality or inequality. And I think his data shows very clearly that when tax rates were high and redistributive, when unions were strong. You know, there are other factors to do with a more industrial economy. Income was more equally distributed than it was once the tax cutting philosophy theory took hold and became the basis of public policy.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, of course, thank you.
One thing.
Yeah, Wilma, go ahead.
Yeah, that one, I'm trying to, the one aspect when they're questioning Republicans or everybody about their perceptions of Democrats or, you know, if you turn that around in a socialism, right? We're all socialists.
Mm-hmm.
Turn that around, ask people what they think of Trumpers, and you get the exact kind of division. And it just proves the divisiveness of our country at this time.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And I highlighted that Republicans think that Democrats are socialists because I was trying to explain who Sinema and Manchin need to respond to. They don't need to respond to Schumer or Pelosi or Warren. They need to respond to the voters who think they belong to a party that's been taken over by socialists. But I think I showed you a couple of weeks ago the mirror image diagram, which is how many Democrats think Republicans are racist. And it's even, I think, a little bit higher than the number of Republicans who think that the Democrats are socialists. So you're right. And please note, right, that you know, one implication of Peggy Noonan and John's point, and I think reading her op-ed to us, is that, look, Biden tried for a year to see if there were Republicans who he could work with, right? And maybe in so doing, he could lower the temperature of partisan divisiveness in Congress and politics. It didn't work. And so now what's he doing? He's becoming angry partisan Joe Biden, right? And so you're probably going to get an amplification or an acceleration of the partisan split in American politics now. If it can get any worse, it looks like that's the way it's headed. All right, everybody, sorry to conclude on that note. I do hope things will continue to get better there. And we'll see each other again next week. Take care, okay? Be careful and see you guys soon. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you, David. Have a good one.
Bye-bye. Thank you.